we're here today at Williamstown to have a dive out on the reef to check in on the condition. So this is a reef that we've been surveying over the last 12 years. We're here today to check back in, see how it's going and see the condition of the reef. I'm also going to be collecting a couple of sea urchins to have a little bit of a feast on afterwards. So this is a standard survey technique that we've been doing for reef surveys across all of Port Phillip Bay. And that's checking in on the reef condition. So what's the kelp cover like? What kind of seaweeds are there? And then part of that is also about the sea urchin densities. The first 50 metres, you don't see as many, but once you get out that bit further, the rest of the 150 metres of this reef is covered in sea urchins. It's really important to survey these reefs and track the condition and how they change over time. Because if we don't know what the problem is, we can't then look at how we can manage that and help solve that problem. And so if we don't actually know how many urchins are there, where the problem urchin barren spots are, then we can't actually tell managers the areas they should be going and trying to restore and to fix. So there's the one main species, which is actually native to Port Phillip Bay, and it's the short-spined sea urchin is one name, or the purple sea urchin is another name for it. But its scientific name is Heliosidaris erythrogramma. So what we think has kind of happened over time is a combination of all of the nutrients actually coming into Port Phillip Bay with all of the sewerage wastewater that's been coming in here since the 50s and 60s really. And that has basically driven a change in this ecosystem from the bottom up. And all of those excess nutrients in the water actually drove a whole lot of other weedy seaweed species to massively proliferate. And when you have a whole lot of food, then other species will come along and make the most of that. And so sea urchins love to sit there on a rock and catch whatever drifting bits of seaweed are coming by. And so with all of this extra seaweed that was now out there and floating around, it built a larger sea urchin population in the bay. But then what happened? We got to the millennium drought, which was from the end of the 1990s and through the 2000s. So a long period of increased temperatures, but also reduced nutrients that were actually now coming into the bay. Now all of a sudden we had less nutrients in the bay and less seaweed that was now growing and proliferating because of it, and that meant we had way more urchins and the seaweed populations were down here. So they switched from couch potato mode to actually active foraging kind of army mode, and instead moving around and eating and clearing all of the seaweeds and the kelps off the reef. And so they would move from reef to reef doing that. And they're actually really good at surviving. So you might think, oh, they've eaten all their food out, maybe they'll die off after that. But sea urchins are particularly clever and particularly good at being able to survive when there's not much food around and being able to kind of linger in this space. And so we actually refer to them, once they've eaten everything and they're moving around this bare, barren landscape, as kind of zombie sea urchins. So they've kind of eaten everything out, but they still wander around. In these areas where the sea urchins are really overabundant, we need to find a way to be able to reduce the urchins down to a healthy level that the reefs can actually handle. We can actually go out and eat them so that you can buy them in the fish shop, or recreational fishers, which is you and me, can collect our daily quota of sea urchins. So you do need to have a recreational fishing license, number one. And the number two is checking the current rules and regulations about how many sea urchins that you can collect. Now at the moment, that's collecting 40 sea urchins per person per day, and making sure that you do that below the intertidal zone. Sea urchins haven't been a regular part of the Australian diet over the last 150 years, but I think as we see, particularly from New Zealand and from Asia, it's a really common part of the cuisine. And so I think through programs like this, we're trying to get the word out to everyone that here's something great you can eat that's sustainable and you're actually helping the environment by eating it.